So you're still attending the NanoElect workshop on bridging the gap between semiconductor technologies and architecture that has been initiated as a side event to Date 20. Pascal is a scientific director of the IC design, architecture, and embedded software teams of CEA in Grenoble. He has been for a very long time involved in NanoElect, leading all the effort on IC design for 3D stacking architectures and design. And he will present today the results of a project that has been running for more than 3 or 4 years now, dealing with a project on using 3D technologies for high performance computing. So, Pascal Vivet, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Hugh, for your introduction. So it's really my pleasure to be here. First time for me to do that kind of thing after many conferences. So I will present you this morning major results that we have been achieving through IRT program that has been initiating many years ago, even more than 3 years ago. I will not recap all that, all the story, but I will present some more detailed results about all the chips that has been presented 3 weeks ago in IACC conference in San Francisco with a major paper. Oops. Okay, so in the context of high performance computing and big data application and all that project has been started in that domain, we continuously want to integrate more cores, more accelerators, more memory. It appears that similar constraints are also appearing for embedded HPC, which is automotive and avionics. So it is not only concerned for big computing farm. And in these domains, we need very generic functions and highly optimized in terms of energy efficiency. They can be either generic as CPU, GPUs, memories, but also highly specialized like machine learning and AI accelerators to answer the greedy computing demand of all these big data applications. In a sustainable world and economy, we need to find, as circuit designer, a solution in order to integrate all these functions and to provide easier system differentiation and a fast way to go to the market for that. It is not viable to do that in a single die solution using advanced CMOS technologies due to the cost and yield issues. And this innovation and this differentiation is not possible through a single die solution. And for that, I strongly believe that chiplet partitioning is the right way to go. For chiplet partitioning, system designers must offer modular, cost-effective solutions, energy efficiency of the system infrastructure, and more on-chip memory bandwidth per core. Actually, chiplet partitioning is not new, and it has been introduced many years ago. And we have been very active through the IRT NanoElect program to introduce all these concepts and technologies. And the motivations of chiplet partitioning are well understood now by all the partners worldwide. First of all, it is driven by cost, because thanks to non-good die sorting, it's possible to yield large systems in advanced CMOS technologies. Second thing, it's driven by modularity, and chiplet partitioning allows the very right way to do modular systems in terms of both functions and functionality and ecosystem. While heterogeneous integrations allows to pick the right technology, oops. While heterogeneous integration allows to pick the right tech, oops. Oh, sure. 2 or 3 seconds. Here we are. While heterogeneous integration allows to pick the right technology for the right functions, such as advanced CMOS technologies for computing, DRAM technology for memory, or OxRAM technologies for AI acceleration, for instance. All these chiplets will be integrated using advanced 3D technologies, which can be done using TSVs, microbumps, or even more advanced technologies. There are various chiplet challenges associated to all that, of course. The first one is ecosystem maturity that will move progressively from IP reuse to chiplet reuse. While in terms of system-level design, this simple Lego cartoon with this nice picture here is not as simple as that, and it needs deep thought in terms of both technology and architecture partitioning. While various challenges are raised regarding circuit design, for instance, on chiplet interfaces, testability, 3D CAD flows, and so on. But now, if we are looking to the state of the art, there are actually existing three main kind of technologies for chiplet partitioning. The first one is organic substrates, which is low cost and providing higher pitch, and it has been adopted, for instance, by AMD in order to do chiplet-based partitioning, presented 2 years ago, and with some very recent and interesting results presented 2 weeks ago in an IACC conference as well. The second one is passive interposer, also called 2.5D integration, using which is more costly, using more aggressive pitch, which is provided by foundry partners such as TSMC and their Cobos technology, and which is currently used for FPGA or HBM memory integration. The last one, Silicon Bridges, is a trade-off between both, which has been adopted by Intel with their EMI bridge, which is a small piece of silicon bridging two different chiplets within the organic substrate. So all these technologies are mature on the market and are currently used in various products massively, but there are still some limitations. The first one, as circuit designer and architect, that we see is that the chiplet communication is limited to side-by-side communication. It is not scalable. We cannot scale to a large number of chiplets by using those technologies. It is not possible. The second one is how to integrate heterogeneous chiplets and differentiating functions through this modular assembly. And the last one is how to integrate less scalable functions such as I/O functions, analogs, power management to bridge between all these different options. And for that, we're going to introduce active interposer. So the principle is as below. So the idea is supposing that you have massive number of chiplets which are composed of cluster of cores, whatever they are, they could be heterogeneous as well. We're going to 3D stack them face to face onto an active interposer, which is a large structure containing CMOS circuits. In order to bridge all these interconnects, all these chiplets together, we're going to integrate scalable and distributed network on chips, allowing any chiplet to chiplet traffic. We're going to integrate power management close to the cores below each chiplet to power supply them. We finally integrate SOC infrastructure such as analogs, files, and design for testability, while finally some free space could be used to preserve and to bring additional features for heterogeneous functions. Mature CMOS technology must be used for such active interposer to preserve the logic density and to preserve the system cost. So after this introduction on chiplet partitioning, I'm going to present into more details this active interposer circuit and its building blocks. So we have designed a complete circuit called Intact, which is an active interposer composed of 6 chiplets, 3D stacked on it. Each chiplet is composed of 4 clusters of 4 cores, so this is 16 cores per chip, with a distributed hierarchy of caches with level 1, level 2, and level 3 caches time. The overall architecture provides a scalable cache currency memory hierarchy. We have 6 of them, and they are 3D stacked face-to-face onto the active interposer, which is integrating distributed flexible interconnects to make the connection between all these objects, integrated switch cap voltage regulator, 1 per chiplet to provide power management for each chip. Finally, memory I/O controller and system I/Os for chip to the system communication. The final image of the system is the following. And we can see the 6 chiplets in FDSOI 28 nanometer technology, 3D stacked onto the active interposer and 65 nanometer technology. And in a nutshell, we are integrating 96 cores. We can notice that we have 2 different technology nodes difference between the chiplets and the bottom line, which is providing enough performances in terms of analog partitioning and IOs in the bottom die compared to the top die. Let's now present in more detail the chiplet main features. So each chip, it contains small 30 bits scalar cores. The memory is physically distributed throughout the hierarchy with level 2 caches and virtual memory support. And we have also adaptive and fault-tolerant L3 caches. And we have introduced and previously published a new and innovative protocol providing cache currency through linked list directory. I will not enter into the details of all that. What we can see in terms of system level interconnect, we have all these styles of computing and caches which are interconnected through 2D mesh NOCs. And we have 3 of them. The blue one, which is interconnecting level 1 to level 2 caches, the green one, which is interconnecting level 2 to level 3 caches, while the last one, the red one, is interconnecting the level 3 caches to the external memory. And those 3 interconnects are extended through the interposer using what are 3D plugs, which are called 3D plugs, excuse me. So if we now focus on the system level interconnects, so these three interconnects, which I've introduced previously in the chiplet, are extended through the active interposer and are integrated as distributed and very flexible interconnects within the active interposer. They integrate multiple network on chips, which are composed of routers and links, which are integrating pipelining, buffering, and retiming for cloud domain crossing. And we are also integrating 3D plug communication IPs to make the communication vertically between the chip and the active interposer. And we have two versions of them, synchronous and asynchronous version, in order to study different performance trade-offs. In terms of chiplet-to-chiplet communication schemes, we have two different schemes, either passive links for chip-to-chip communication without any routing and buffering, and we have active links for long-reach communication between L2 and L3 and L3 to external memory, which is allowing any chiplet-to-chiplet scalable traffic. If we zoom in terms of layout, how all that is done, this is the layout of the chiplet, and you can see the different clusters of computing with level 1 caches, level 2 caches, level 3 caches. And in each corner of the chip, we can see four 3D plugs, which are providing the physical interface and the logical interface to communicate with the active interposer, which is just below. If we zoom in, we can see a matrix of microbumps, which is technology provided by the RRT program, which has been fabricated in the Leti fab, with microbumps with a very aggressive pitch of 20 micrometers. Below this matrix of microbumps, we can see microbuffer standard cells and the glue logic of the interface. And this interface provides this logic and pipelining interface, microbumps, standard cells, and testability features as well. If we zoom in the microbuffer standard cells, which has been designed done jointly between ST and ourselves, we have bidirectional drivers, ESD protection for clean assembly, pull-up and level shifters so that we can bridge the power domain between the top chip and the bottom chip. Main results about the circuit. The 3D plug, we have the best throughput for the synchronous version with 1.2 gigahertz. For the interposer, we have similar throughput between the synchronous NUC and the asynchronous NUC, about 1 gigahertz. But we have the best latency for the asynchronous NUC. Supposing that we want to communicate between that chip and that chip, we're able to achieve a propagation speed of less than 1 nanosecond per millimeter, which is 3 to 5 times better than the state of the art for synchronous NUC version, and we are very pleased for that. And this latency reduction is very important for cache coherency traffic, but this comes at the cost of some energy. So with all these numbers, we see that we need a combination of different interconnect types to achieve different performance trade-offs. Let's now go to the switch cap voltage regulators. So as I presented below, we have distributed power supply units providing voltage and frequency scaling below each chiplets that are providing reduced higher drop effects. It is fully integrated. There is no external passive components, and we are using SiC oxide transistors using this 65 nanometer technology. We have only on-chip capacitance composed of MOS and MOM and MIM with a large capacitance density, and about 50% of the chiplet area is dedicated to this switch cap voltage regulator, which is integrated into the interposer. Regarding design for testability, we have, of course, some challenges in terms of testability. We need to test the dies for non-good die sorting. We need to test also the active interposer and the final package. And we have also some issues about test access because we need to test probes on some very small objects, so we are probing on some additional 2D pads. A flexible 3D DFT architecture has been proposed using combination of parallel scan chains and IJ tag interface. I will not enter into all the details, but all that has been done and implementing using mentor tools called Tessent, which has been used for DFT insertion and automatic test pattern generation, and it has been published the previous years as well. We would like also to present some more details about the 3D design flow, which has been developed jointly into the program. So the main achievements, so we have done a close cooperation and optimization between the 3D CAD tools and the 3D circuit design, uncovering wide aspects of the system, of the circuit design aspects. Architecture, physical implementation, and 3D sign-off. In terms of architecture, we have been using expedition tools for system partitioning and packaging co-design, thermal profiling at system level using an advanced tool called Sahara for early thermal analysis, DFT using Tessent tools, and all the sign-off with Calibre tools for DRC, LVS verification, thermal sign-off, parasitics, and electromigration as well. We have also some early results on to thermal, but I will not present that into more details. I would like to spend more time on to the conclusion. So circuit results. Here are the cross-section of the design. So chiplets are implemented in FD-SOI 28 nanometer technology from ST, fabricated in ST Crawl Fab. Active interposer in 65 nanometer technology with MIM option, fabricated by ST as well. 3D technology has been performed by IT partners, so ST and Leti. And we can see the cross-section of the device with the chiplet, microbumps, pitch of 20 micrometer technology, active interposer in 65 with TSVs, allowing the cross-section to go from the front face to the bottom face and the package substrate. We can see here the floor plan and layout of the two chips, the chiplet and the active interposer, and the final package. More cross-section of the device, which has been presented at the ECTC 2019 conference last May, which has received the Best Paper Award, and we are very proud of that, and with some very nice pictures and more electrical results. And we can see zoom of the two structures of the chiplet, the active interposer again, and the copper pillars, and with clean assembly of the interposer to the package and clear alignment, which has been achieved. Circuit performances now. So circuit is able to achieve wide voltage range from 0.5 volts all the way to 1.1 volt using back biasing in FD-SOI. We are achieving a peak performance of 220 gigahops for all the 96 cores at 1.15 gigahertz. Best energy efficiency is achieved at low voltage with an energy efficiency of 10 gigahops per watt. Power consumption breakdown, more interestingly, we can see that about two-thirds of the overall system is dedicated to the chiplet, with half in the cores and the second half in the level two and level three caches, while only 3% of the interposer of the power consumption is dedicated to the interposer logic for all the interconnects for chip-to-chip communication, while 70% of the power budget is dedicated to the interposer switch cap voltage regulator, which are the power loss within the voltage regulator in order to power supply the chiplets. If we now compare to state of the art, so we are the first one to introduce, compared to previous work from Intel, AMD, TSMC, or Intel again, active interposer, which are integrating some extra features within the logic. High yield is expected on that kind of object. Aggressive pitch has been achieved for the microbumps. Voltage regulators achieves a very high energy efficiency as 82% because we are integrating all the capacitance within the active interposer compared to previous work, which were limited in terms of dedicated area available in that. While in terms of interconnects, higher bandwidth density of 3 terabytes per second per millimeter square has been achieved, which is 2 times better than state of the art. And we are the first one to report so many number of chiplets integrated onto a single substrate with so many number of cores, about 100 cores. So let's conclude the talk. So through the IIT program and a program of about 5 to 6 years, I would say, it has been quite a long and very tedious effort by all the design and technology team to achieve those results. We have been able to show this chiplet partitioning onto an active interposer, integrating both interconnects, power management, and IOs. 3 terabits per second per millimeter square bandwidth is achieved, and this is a very high number in terms of state of the art, and we are very proud of that. Low latency interconnect using asynchronous interconnect is possible for long distance communication, while power management fully integrated allows to power supply the chip. All these benefits and IPs allows to increase energy efficiency and the chip memory bandwidth per core. Second conclusion also is that we have been able to set up through the IIT program a mature 3D design flow and tools thanks to an active collaboration with Mentor Graphics. For the perspectives, chiplet ecosystems, there will be a progressive setup of the chiplet ecosystem. It is already appearing for high performance computing on the United States side. ABM, AMD, Intel, everybody is working on that, but it will also appear very shortly, and we are working on that, on embedded HPC for automotive and AI acceleration. An active interposer can be an enabler for differentiation, integrating heterogeneous functions on chiplets. More perspectives. The first one is in terms of technology, aggressive hybrid bonding, fine pitch, chip-to-chip interconnect with 3 to 5 micrometer speech is ongoing work to optimize chipletization. And the second one is photonic interposer for more chip-to-chip bandwidth and lower latency. So I really thank you for attending this talk and presentation. If you have any questions, I will be pleased to answer it.
Okay, so there is a question from David. Do you have any views, or can you share any views on the standardization of the chiplet signaling and protocols?
Okay, thanks, David. So this is a really good question, and there are some many initiatives worldwide on that. There is one standard group working on that through the OCP standardization industrial group, and the group is called ODSA, Open Design Standardization Hardware, something like that, I forgot. And we have not been participating yet, but we have discussions about that, and we know the people. And clearly, chiplet standardization will be a way to bridge all the chips together onto those substrates. And the second question is that as long as those standards are not existing, because many people will provide their own chiplet with their own protocol. So suppose that you have chiplet A with protocol A and you want to integrate it with chiplet B of protocol B, the only solution to bridge them is to use active interposer to glue them together through active circuits within the active interposer.